On August 31, 2009, former Ontario Attorney General Michael Bryant was charged with the death of cyclist Darcy Sheppard. All the charges against him were eventually dropped. But the 28 seconds of confrontation between Sheppard and Bryant on Bloor Street on the night of Bryant's 12th wedding anniversary changed his and many other lives forever. Joining us now, Michael Bryant, author of 28 Seconds, A True Story of Addiction, Tragedy, and Hope. Welcome back.
Good to be here.
We're going to get into this tonight. I want to start with this, because I would have thought that you would want to put that 28 seconds
right.
well behind you.
Right.
And yet you write a book about it, guaranteed to bring it all back. How come?
I guess a couple reasons. One, to be helpful. I was helped by a lot of people. And one group of people that I was helped with, who I've never really been able to thank, is authors who wrote very open stories, talked about their either their addiction or and alcoholism or their tragedy. It may have nothing to do with the other. Given what I got out of it, I felt, well, I have a story that maybe people might find some comfort from the experience. So the first one was an offering. Like, here you go. I hope this is helpful to you. And then the second one was, I, over the last few years, I've had conversations with people where it's clear to me that they want to talk about what happened during the 20 seconds. They want to find out what's happened in my life, and they're afraid to do so.
It's
and
awkward.
It is very awkward. It's not a, oh, you're that Michael Bryant. And I often go into a, not often, but sometimes I would go into a social setting, and suddenly it was a wake or a shiva. And until at a shiva or a wake, until somebody makes the first joke, it just tense. And
so now the story's out there, and people can know.
Yeah, and I'm not afraid to talk about it. So it's out there.
Let me follow up on one of the things you mentioned in that first answer, namely your alcoholism.
Yes.
I have to tell you, I've known you since 1999 when you got into public life. I had not one clue that you were an alcoholic. Was I typical in that respect?
Yeah. Yeah. There were some people who I was close to who were aware that there was issues. Over the years, I've had a couple people, a handful of people who I spoke to about this, or they raised it with me because they could, they had someone in their life who, typically a family member, had been an alcoholic, and so they could see the signs, if you like. No, you were in good company.
And yet, you were the Attorney General of Ontario, an alcoholic who occasionally, as the cliche goes, sort of, you know, ended up in the gutter some night, and you managed to do your job.
Right.
How did you do that?
There are high-functioning alcoholics in the world. Historically, there are people who, I asked my GP, I said, I don't think I'm an alcoholic. Because I'm in my eyes, successful and I'm elected and so on. I thought that alcoholics are people who can't function. And he said, well, I don't know, Winston Churchill, saved the Western world while drinking a lot every day and night.
So it can be done.
It can be done. And for me, it was actually as much sustaining the adrenaline high or rush and attention on myself that one would get from that attorney general job. So the issue was never about my energy level when I was during the day. Mm-hmm. It was, okay, now how do you turn it off? And I wasn't able to turn it off.
Well, speaking of turning it off, how did you actually quit? Because you don't touch it anymore, do you?
No, yeah, that's right. It's been 6 years, it's a process. You know, it's for everybody. It's a process, and sometimes it's short. I met people who their drinking career is short and their quitting career is short.
You quit numerous times before you actually quit, right?
I tried to manage it. I was of the view that I just needed to learn how to moderate my drinking. And the final way by which I stopped, I didn't want to stop. Let's be clear. I loved it too much. And I couldn't imagine life without it. And But I had basically somebody hold up a mirror to me. And it's when you undergo that rigorous honesty with yourself and then you see what's really going on, that's when one comes to realize that you just got to give up. And in my case, I went to see a psychiatrist and he said, keep a journal. Talk to me about how you're going to moderate your drinking, not to me, talk to the journal. So I kept a journal of what turned out to be my drunkalogue. And I was able to see vividly that I was deluding myself, I was making promises to myself, and I wasn't keeping them. And I clearly was powerless over alcohol. And increasingly, my life was becoming unmanageable. And as a result of that, I just, at a certain moment, gave up.
You're going to forgive my interest here. Did you ever show up drunk to a cabinet meeting?
No. Never drunk on the job. This show, I recall, used to tape at 8 o'clock.
It was live at 8 o'clock.
Live at 8 o'clock. Mm-hmm. And I, at a certain point, stopped doing it because that's prime drinking time. 8 o'clock, and I noticed that. I thought to myself, why have I not done that show? Why have I not been on Steve Paikin's show for the last year? And I thought, it's because it's cutting into my drinking time. And that, so it was beginning to, when I stopped, it was beginning to creep into hour, you know, minute by minute, it was going to start creeping into my ability to perform as an MPP and an attorney general.
There are numerous producers of this program who are now saying, oh, that's why I couldn't book them. Okay, I get it now.
Yeah.
Michael, I want to take you to August 31st, 2009. And I know you've told this story a lot of times, so we're going to do something a little different tonight so that you don't have to tell it again. Because you actually wrote it in this book. You're out with your wife, it's your anniversary, an addict named Darcy Sheppard comes up to your convertible, takes a swing at you, and the next 20 seconds are going to change your and his life forever. I'm going to take you to page 125. And if you would, starting from the red, just read the underlined passages over the ensuing pages, and this will put all your cards on the table.
Okay. I put the sob in reverse. As I was looking back, Shepard hurled his backpack containing a heavy bike lock at us. It went sailing over my head. I put the car in first gear and tried to drive around him. Outraged, he raced toward the front of the car. I remember Susan screaming, "Oh my God," over and over. Chasing after us, he leapt at the sob as if in slow motion. Shepard landed hip first to break his fall, the way you see stuntmen as cops do the hood slide on crime shows. It made a crunching noise. I felt the impact of a man over 200 pounds landing on my car. He then grabbed the windshield wiper and bent it back towards him. He began pulling himself toward me, hand over hand, as if the wiper were a rope. The strength of the man was extraordinary. He seemed almost superhuman. His upper torso was now on the hood's edge, driver's side, with the car moving forward. He swung around, put his right arm inside the door, his left armpit around the side mirror. He held up his legs, a feat of some strength, no doubt assisted by the adrenaline that I later learned Darcy so often sought. The car suddenly swerved sharply to the left, almost 45 degrees. I have no recollection how that happened. He must have grabbed the wheel. In wrestling for control of the car, we crossed to the south side of the street, heading westbound into the eastbound lane. Then he said to me with a crooked grin, after we had stopped for a moment, "You're not getting away that easy." Then he started climbing in the car. Susan grew louder and more frantic. "No, no, no, stop, 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 stop." This was the only physical contact between us. The car remained stopped while this shoving was going on. I was struggling with Darcy Sheppard for control of the vehicle. Then he was gone. All of a sudden, he just wasn't there. I didn't see him fall. I heard a sound, maybe a groan.
You didn't know it, but he was dead.
Right.
As you read that, do you still replay the events of that night in your head and ask yourself, I wonder if there's anything I could have done that would have had the outcome be different?
Yeah, I think about it a lot. And then I think about it again. Sure. Something different might have been done. In my mind, I've sort of broken it down to two other options. One is I get out of the car and something happens. And that one could end badly for me and for Susan, who was in the car. And then the second option is that I just sit there, that I don't do anything. And the fear at the time that led me to not do that was that I felt like I was under attack. But I think getting away from a situation that to me seems so threatening, I think that that was the, I think that, you know, obviously knowing what I know now, I never would have left the house in the first place. I never would have got in the car. I would have put the top up and so on. But under the same circumstances, I probably would have tried to get away again. In the fight or flight option, the flight seemed like the way to go. And it just, but you know, any way I look at it, it ends in a tragedy. I don't know, that's the best I can do.
The police, of course, arrive. They end up treating you somewhat aggressively. They put you in handcuffs. Do they know you're the Attorney General of Ontario at that time?
No,
They don't know?
I don't think so. And you know, I think it is standard procedure when you're detaining someone to put you in cuffs and put you in the back seat. Whether or not it made sense to do so as quickly as they did is obviously an open question.
Do you think they overcompensated and treated you more harshly than you otherwise might have been because they wanted it to look as if you weren't getting special treatment?
Yeah, I think there's two things that went on with this investigation that I take issue with. And the first one is a universal concern, and that is that an investigation involves laying a charge too early. And that's one that applies to me and applies to others. And interestingly, I think that that applied to me before they had any idea who I was. I say that because they when they were reading their rights to me, I at some point I said, no, believe me, I'm aware. And they didn't seem to see why I was saying that. It was a stupid thing for me to say, but anyways. But then the second concern was once I was in the station and the homicide detective showed up and they had to make a decision about whether to release me and to what to charge me with, ultimately, was it going to be manslaughter and so on? At that point, I think, had I not been the former Attorney General, they would have, I think, released me, then finished the investigation, looked at the videotape, looked at the forensic report, the engineer's report, finished interviewing witnesses, gathered all the evidence and then made a decision based on that evidence.
The police's view is that they gave you special treatment in a positive way. They let you have a press conference at the police station. They let you bring in a change of clothing.
Right.
They let you have a public relations company advise you and give you some help at what was clearly a pretty intense moment for you. Did you see that side of it?
That wasn't my impression. I mean, I think the media was on the lawn in front of the station, and I don't think the police have ever pushed them off the lawn. I asked if getting a suit was okay. My recollection was that when police get arrested and they get released, and then are immediately swarmed by media. My recollection was they were always in a suit. So that's where I got the idea that maybe it was okay. And then I also thought if I was in a suit, then my kids wouldn't think that was odd. Like otherwise they'd say, why is daddy in a t-shirt? And I didn't want them wearing.
There was that line, that story in the book, let me look for it here. You and Louie are playing and Louie says, daddy, I want to play car crash with you.
Yeah.
How did you react to that?
Well, I thought that there's probably a psychologist, child psychologist out there who will say that this is great and he's processing this. But I also thought this is too much for me to participate in right now, that's for sure. It was, it sort of sucked the air out of my lungs. You know, that he was trying to figure out what had happened. It was a little abstract to him. It was, this was within 24 hours of it happening. It wasn't abstract to me. And
well, let me hit you with the question that you know, there are people in this province,
right.
some of them cyclists, obviously,
right.
others from so-called addicted communities, who think you got away with murder.
Right.
What do you say to them?
I can't control what they think and the conclusions that they've come to. And, you know, I've told my story. I've put it in the book, and people can accept it or not accept it. That's in part what I mean by it's an offering. I understand people are going to draw their own conclusions.
The Crown investigated. They brought him in from out of province so there wouldn't be a conflict. He decided this should not go to trial, and legally speaking, it was over for you. You tell us in the book that you went out, rented a car, because you hadn't driven since this happened. You rented a convertible.
Sure.
Which is what you were driving that night.
Right.
Michael, as the kids would say, whiskey tango foxtrot. I mean, what were you thinking going out renting a convertible?
Yeah, I mean, I wasn't, as you can imagine, not everything I do in my life is for public consumption, right? So I was not thinking about how it would look. I still don't feel like people necessarily will recognize me, and I wasn't trying to make a statement. I felt like I'd been under a cloud and had been back in the shadows. And the last time I'd been in the shadows had been when I was drinking. And I don't like living in the shadows. And I personally, and I know this is goofy, but I like being outside and I like being in the sun. And I wanted to, it was like a personal statement,
okay.
which I immediately regretted because I found myself A, in a traffic jam, and B, getting phone calls from my friends saying, put the top up and go home.
No kidding.
Which I did.
Well, this just in, there are people out there who don't necessarily think completely kindly about you.
Right.
Even before all this happened. And there's a line in this book, I'm going to read it here. If I ever find myself involved in politics again, it will be for the original reasons, human connection and service to others. And as soon as I read that line, I asked myself, don't you realize that by putting in a line that says, if I ever find myself in politics again, you are giving ammunition to those who think this is a big PR exercise to lay the ground for a comeback?
Right. Again, I personally think no matter what I do and how I write it, this can be perceived as a, I mean, I've heard this said that it's a ploy somehow.
It's keeping your name out there. It's keeping the options open, keeping the door open. That's the stuff you hear.
I understand the view. I get it. And I don't, I mean, I can't debate it or won't debate it. Time will tell, right? I think that when I said that, I was trying to emphasize the part about being a politician that involves human connection. I was not trying to emphasize my political plans. I think once you're a politician, no matter what you say, people always, with some exceptions, think of you as a politician. And up until a certain age, they ask you, are you going to run again? Are you going to run again? Are you gonna? Because that's how they think of you. Not unlike when a journalist ends up working with a government, say on the communication side, people say, are you ever going to go back to journalism. Some of that's human nature, and some of it is, taking a fairly traditional, maybe cynical look at what I'm up to. But what I'm up to is what I've said I'm doing. I'm trying to share my experience, strength, and hope with people with a view to being helpful.
It's not an unreasonable question because your grandfather was in politics, your father was in politics, you were in politics.
Yeah.
And 2.5 years ago when you were on this program, not as a politician, but rather as a guy who'd just been hired by Invest Toronto to put this city on the map and bring international investment here, we talked about this then.
Mm-hmm.
Roll tape, please.
You don't leave your seat and you don't leave cabinet unless you're really serious about doing that. And unless you're really serious about leaving public life. Some people leave and think they might come back, and then they find out, I hope it's fair to say like Frank McKenna, that they like private life a lot and they don't want to go back.
Oh, but he's tempted all the time. And you know he is. And every time there's a vacancy, his name's always at the top
sure
of the list.
Sure he is. And if I gave you some Marshall-esque never, 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 never thing, you would say I don't believe you. And look, it is not where my head is at all.
Okay, you're that's a long time ago. And mm-hmm. so it's a different lifetime ago in some respects.
Yeah.
So you are a changed person now, but there's that line in the book. So as people try to figure out whether you do have political aspirations still someday, what do you say?
I don't know. I know it's a really unsatisfactory answer, but it's the best answer I can give people. I am really focused and interested in the issues that I talk about in the book around addiction treatment, mental health, and the criminal justice system. I don't know the best way for me to be a part of those issues. Right now, I do it on a volunteer basis. If I was going to do it for a living, there are different ways to do that, and I don't know which one is the most effective, and it will, you know, it will maybe depend on what comes up. I do know that government up until now has not been able to, or just has not, made a serious run at addressing the absurdity of the corrections criminal justice system when it comes to mental health and addiction. And maybe that's a very good reason not for me not to go back into that world that has not been able to crack that nut.
One of the things this book has not got a lot of attention for, but which is really good about, is talking about the nature of the relationship between you and the current Premier of Ontario. And we're going to do that on the web. So let me thank you right now for this, for television, and invite people to join us on our website, theagenda.tvo.org, where we're going to get into you and Dalton McGuinty and all of your years as Attorney General. Michael Bryant, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.